James chapter 2, verse 23. Scripture was fulfilled which says, Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. Amen. Heavenly Father, we love you so much, and thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing in our lives. Thank you for this Sabbath day. We worship you in spirit and in truth, and thank you so much for all of your provision, Lord, for your healing power. There are many who we are remembering in prayer, the ones who are listed in our bulletin, plus Ron and the others that we know of as well. Ask also for those who have special needs, spiritually or financially, physically, emotionally. Lord, you know them. You know their situation. Ask that you would intervene in their behalf. Lord, to have your way in their lives, that your will be done in them and through them and through us all. Ask that you fill us all with your Spirit. Lord, that you'd bless our speaker, Douglas Garcia, Elder Garcia, as he presents the message today, that you would speak your words through him, Lord, so that we can receive of the blessing that you have in mind for us today. Be glorified and honored in everything we do and everything we say. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church family. Before we begin, can we bow our heads for a prayer? Our dear Heavenly Father, we need you to come close to us right now. We need to understand the things of heaven, and we need the Holy Spirit, Lord, to reveal that and to impress that upon our hearts. So be with us now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You know, Sayuri Rodriguez and myself, we do a program down at Better Life for television called Stories of Faith. And what we do is a half hour where we talk about things that God has done nowadays, the miracle stories that are happening all around us that most people don't know. A lot of people might say that God stopped doing miracles when the Bible stopped being written. But we're finding that there's miracle stories all over the place. The Lord is intervening in our lives in ways we could have never have imagined. And so Sayuri and I get on the program and we tell the people this. And we explain the situations that's going on. And when I began, I wondered how many stories we would have to tell, how far we could go. But this last week, you know, we recorded program number 22. And I said, Sayuri, we've been going 22 half-hour programs? That seems like a lot of talking. If you had told me I would have done that back when I was in 7th or 8th grade, when I was very shy, I would have said, how can you talk for 22 half-hour programs? But somehow, we've got things to say when the Lord's involved. And people are seeing, and you know they're responding to it. It is one of the most commented about programs, because because people want to see God working today. One day, Sayuri was in Walmart, and she was, this is when back when they still had their foster kids, and she had to take the little girl to the bathroom. So she's in there, and she had some stuff, so she's by the door watching the stuff. She's trying to comfort the girl. I'm here, it's okay, within it. And so she's talking back and forth in the Walmart bathroom. There's a lady in there, and she goes, you're the story lady. You're the lady. And she didn't know what she was talking about until it finally dawned on her, this lady was referring to the program that she did. And she said, yes, yes, yes. And so they started talking. And I think she invited her to church and everything. That was just somebody out in the public. People want to hear what God is doing. I believe in practical religion. For me, it needs to be practical. It needs to be every day. How does it help me? What do we do now? How does it work? That kind of thing. And so, when it comes to fancy words and all these kinds of things, justification and sanctification, I usually steer clear of those, and I say what I want to say in everyday common talk. Even the word faith, I kind of tend to stay away from, because for a lot of people, they've got a false idea and it really doesn't make sense. So I use other words when I want to explain something about faith, even. But I think I'm in good company, because let's look at something for a second. That's the title of the sermon, Does God Play Favorites? And you're going to find out what that means in just a minute. But how did Jesus preach? Did you ever stop to think about and analyze, how did Jesus preach? How did he approach people? Well, point number one I appreciate is plain words of truth. He said the truth, but he used plain words. You didn't have to go to Jesus to have him to use those $10 words that people sometimes like to use. He just spoke it out every day, common language. Anyone could understand. A child could understand. An older person could understand. Another thing he did was that he used stories. I love stories. The program we do is about stories. People are responding to stories. That's the way Jesus did it. Another thing he did was he quoted from the Old Testament, quoting from the Bible. Another thing that Jesus did in his preaching. He spoke with confidence. Do you remember the quote that says the people were saying, boy, he speaks as though someone with authority. The Pharisees of the day were kind of hemming and hawing about everything, but Jesus spoke with authority. And the last thing that I noticed that Jesus did was sometimes he piqued the listener's curiosity. He'd give them a riddle or a story and ask their opinion about. He would tell them something that seemed a little bit like, what is he trying to say, to get their minds going. So I had decided that that's what I want to do. When I speak of the things about the Bible, I want to do it like Jesus did it. Plain English, just it is. So that's how I approach religion myself. And I wanted to bring that to you today. Today's topic, does God play favorites, for me is a practical question. And you're going to say, how in the world did that topic come up in your mind? I was thinking about the people that I've known about in my life, some friends, some Bible characters, and I noticed certain things happen to them. For instance, have any of you read the book by Roger Morneau about Incredible Answers to Prayer, when you need more incredible answers to prayer? I think our library has it. But Roger Morneau was a big believer in prayer. And he tells the story that one day he was out having lunch, because he was a salesman for the Yellow Pages. He was out having lunch in his car in the parking lot of a mall. And as he was sitting there enjoying his lunch, a car pulls up next to him, and out comes a couple, which they appear to be a husband and wife. When they get out of the car, though, instantly the air is broken up with arguing and bitterness, and oh, I don't know what had happened, but they were going at it. You know, why do you do this? Why do you do that? It was just going, and of course it disturbed his lunch. But Roger is a man of prayer, so what he did was he went to the Lord. And he said, Lord, please come upon these people. Send your Holy Spirit, because of the blood of your Son who died on the cross, intervene in these people's lives. And as he was praying for them, the most amazing thing happened. He said it was like, I thought it was like turning off a light switch. The people's personality just transformed right in front of him. They all of a sudden started to get apologetic with each other. And he said, before you knew what happened, they were like going arm in arm, like, you know, like a boyfriend, girlfriend, into the mall, just like that. When I read that, I said, has anything like that ever happened with me, you know, in my presence? And then my mind also goes to David Gates. Do you all know who David Gates is? He's a missionary, does a lot of things, works a lot in South America. He has had some amazing stories, things happen to him. One of my favorite stories, I may have shared it here before, let me recap it though if I have. One of his most amazing stories for me is the time that they were in Peru and they got a shipment of computers in. This was to be used in the conference, I think at the schools, maybe the hospital. And they needed to pick it up from the docks down there in Lima, Peru, I think it was. And so he took his old station wagon down to the docks to pick up the computers. He was having trouble because the starter wasn't working. He had to get it replaced. So in order to get the car even going, he had to have some guys push him to get the starter to turn over. So that's the situation he found himself in. He goes down to pick up the computers at the dock, and he picks them up, fills up the car, has to get some guys there to help him push so he can get the car going again, to start it again. And he decides that he's going to try to save some time by cutting through a bad part of town. That wasn't a good idea. As he was going through the bad part of town, all of a sudden steam or whatever starts coming out of the engine, and the thing like freezes up, and he pulls over, his car stops. He stops on a slight incline, in gravel, with a car full of computers. He's dressed up with like a suit and tie kind of a situation going on, and he pulls up next to an old abandoned bus. In the bad part of town, do you know what old abandoned buses meant? Drug activity, the hangout, the gang hangouts. So do you think that he stood out as he was there, broken down? And he said, I need to get some help here. So I think he saw water coming out from underneath, so he wanted to go to one of the storefronts to get water. He was able to get some water, came back to pour it in the car, and he said it came right through. It just wasn't doing it. Storefronts were closing. It was that time of the day where they were closing. So he was about to be really on his own in a big way. He's sitting there thinking, what should he do? When two guys approach the car, and they're doing this thing where you size up the situation, and they did not look like good guys. And they come up to the car, they're sizing up the situation, and he notices in their hands they have two big rocks. It's like they're checking him out. Is this guy armed? And you can look through windows, you know how cars are, you can see what's inside. And I think that they were saying, this is gonna be pretty good. We got some computers here, we got some stuff. And so he's thinking to himself, what am I gonna do? So he starts praying, Lord, what am I supposed to do? I know you might ask me sometimes to give my life in exchange for another human, but I don't think you're asking me to give my life in exchange for some computers. But David said, I can't imagine though these computers falling into the wrong hands because they're for your work. So what are we supposed to do? David said that he took a step backwards because he decided he had better leave the situation, that God would not ask him to give his life for those computers. And he says that when he took a step backwards, he walked into somebody. He turned around, and here was a man. Now remember, he's on the street, so he's kind of seen for himself if anyone's around. He didn't know where this guy came from. He turns around, and he says he was stunned for a second because he looked into this guy's face, and he said it was the most beautiful face he'd ever seen. He was thinking to himself, if he was in Hollywood, he would be a movie star. So that's how big of a thing it was. I was like, boy, this guy, he looks like he should be a movie star. But then he came back to where he was, the danger he was in, and the guy said, you need to get in your car and leave. Your life is in danger. And David said, well, I can't. My car's broken down, and we're parked on an incline, and I'm in gravel, and it took several guys to push me just to get me started. I can't go anywhere. And the man forcefully insisted, you get in your car, I'll push you. And the guy, David goes, yeah, you're going to push me. He gets into his car, and he looks over at the guys as he's getting into his car, who with the rocks, remember those guys? He says they look like they were frozen, standing statues. They weren't doing anything. David gets in the car. The guy goes next to the car, and he pushes him by himself, uphill, on an incline, through gravel, and the car starts moving. It starts. Now, David knows in that culture that if somebody does something for you, you have to give them a tip. So he stops the car, it's running still, but he stops, physically stops the car and says, here, I have to give you the tip. The man who just pushed him by himself said, no, I don't need your money, just go. And David says, nope, I got to give you a tip. He pulls out a few dollars or something and gives it to the guy. And the guy says, now go, get out of here, go, go. And David takes off and drives a few more blocks down before his car stalls again, but this time in a much better part of town. And David didn't think of it at the time, but he said afterwards you start to think about these things. Hold on. Who was that guy? How could he push by himself? Where did he come up? And why wasn't he afraid for his own safety? David thinks he sent an angel. God sent an angel. And I think he did too. So there's stories like this that happen. I think, has that anything like that ever happened to me? And then there was an incredible story that happened to one of my friends that I just love telling, and I may have told it already because I love it so much. And that's the story about my friend Juanita Kretschmeyer. Some of you know Juanita. She spent her whole life in ministry, much of it in ministry. And one time she had a pet bird, one of those big, colorful, I don't know if it's called a parrot or a something. And it liked to go into the bathroom and when they were taking showers because they liked the steam. So Sabbath morning, they're getting ready for church. They put it up on the door frame so that it can enjoy the mist of the steam from the shower as pastor gets ready for church. He comes out of the shower, getting all cleaned up and stuff, and he forgets the bird is on the top of the door frame. He slams the door shut. He hears a screech. He looks over and instantly knows what happened. He forgot the bird was there. He looked down, there was the bird on the floor. He got down and checked real close. One of its legs was hanging on by a tendon. He called for his wife. She ran in. He said, oh, we got to help the bird. I have to go to church. Call the vet. Here, you take the bird. You go to the vet. They were trying to figure out what in the world they were going to do in this unexpected situation for their little pet. They said, before we do anything, let's stop and pray and talk to the Lord about this real quick. So they put the bird on a piece of newspaper between them, and they bow their heads and pray. When they open their eyes, the leg is restored back to the bird. They look at it, and they think to themselves, have we gone crazy? Did we see what we just saw? Well, they didn't see it because they were praying. But did what happened just happen? On the newspaper, there's still the blood from the bird. But the bird is fine. They carefully check it out. The only thing wrong with the bird is there's a little chip on the on its fingernail. Not fingernail, claw nail. And so that's the sign that something did happen. But otherwise, the bird is fine, looking around like nothing's wrong. And I thought to myself, well, nothing like that has ever happened to me. So I was thinking about these things, these different people. And then in the Bible, there's something else. Have you ever read, let's take a look at a Bible text real quick. You know John the disciple? Let me put this on the screen for you. Here's from John 19, verse 26. You probably have heard a phrase like this before. When Jesus, therefore, saw his mother and the disciple who he loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." This is at the cross, of course. But what I want you to focus on is the phrase, "the disciple who Jesus loved." That wasn't the only time this phrase appears in the Bible. So I was thinking, John, the disciple who Jesus has loved. Then there's this quote in the Spirit of Prophecy I want to share with you. The apostle John was distinguished above his brethren as the disciple whom Jesus loved. He seemed to have enjoyed, in a preeminent sense, the friendship of Christ. And he received many tokens of the Savior's confidence and love. He was one of the three permitted to witness Christ's glory upon the Mount of Transfiguration and his agony in Gethsemane. And to the care of John, our Lord confided his mother in those last hours of anguish upon the cross. So I started thinking about that. I said, I know God is no respecter of persons because you have verses like this in Acts 10 that says, "Then Peter opened his mouth and said, 'In truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality.'" So God is not partial, but boy, John was sure enjoying some special relationship with Christ. My friends, who I've just told their stories, seem to have a special relationship with God and Christ. And I started going, is God playing favorites? That's how this question came about. So I prayed to understand what was going on. Have you ever done that? Have you ever needed to ask God a question about why? You look at the scriptures, something's unclear to you, why? We've done that several times. I've done this several times. And I go to the Lord and I ask him directly, "Lord, would you please explain this?" But other people have too. At Better Life, we got a call from a man who said, "I've been praying to the Lord to get an answer." He lived up in Roseburg. "I needed to know something from the Lord. I prayed it to him." And he said, "Then I turn on Better Life, and there's the answer." Just what he was asking for, there's the answer. A man in Portland called, talked to us once, and he was looking for more information about prophecy and the book of Revelation. One day he turned on his TV. Our channel was now on his TV set. It wasn't there before. His wife had not programmed it in. And he saw many programs about prophecy on our channel. So I've seen this happen over and over again. Recently I asked the Lord something about something I read in Exodus. I said, "Lord, why is this? This does not seem right. What does this mean?" And probably within a day or so, he had given me the answer. So that's the way I do it. And I hope that you found that working for you too. So anyway, I took this particular program, "Lord, you play favorites." I took that to the Lord in prayer. I said, "I need to understand what's going on here." And in this case, the Lord answered my prayer by running my mind through a little conversation. And what I'm going to do now is explain, I put it in conversational tone here for you to understand, even though it might not be word for word what happened to me. You'll get the idea of the conversation the Lord and I had. So I asked the Lord, "Lord, do you play favorites?" The Lord says something to me like, "Doug, you're friends with the so-and-so family." "Yes, I am." "You met them in college." "Yes, I did." "There's five children in that family when you met them in college." "Yeah." "Now, years later, there's, seems like approaching 20 grandchildren added to that whole thing." "Yeah, that's right." "Do you love them?" "Well, yeah, they're like another family to me." "Are you close to all the grandchildren, their children, in the same way?" I said, "Well, no, I'm not close to them all in the same way." "Why?" "Well, because sometimes I get to see certain families more often than others. And I particularly spend a lot of time at one of my friends' homes." "And in that home, Doug, how many children are there?" "There's three." And of those three children, are you particularly close to any? And I said, well, yes, I am. Over the years, I particularly got close to one of my friend's son. His name is Danny. There he is. Now, to give you some idea, Danny's going to turn 18 this year. So I've been their friends since pretty much the day he was born. I've been with that family, visiting on and off all through the course of time. But Danny in particular is the one of their children that I've gotten close to. Of all the 15 to 20 kids that are now there, he's the one I particularly got close to. So then I started thinking, why is that? Well, when I visited, he was always the one who was excited. Have you ever gone to somebody's home and someone in particular is really happy to see you? That was him. He was always looking to be around whenever I was there. What's going on? What are you doing? And very outgoing. We would go to the park. We went to the park once and I made up a game. And it's just, you know, you go to the swings, what's it called? Not the swing sets, the jungle gym kind of thing. And I would chase them around and growl like a bear. And I said, let's go play bear. I think I did that once or twice, and all of a sudden, whenever I come back, let's go play bear, let's go play bear, let's go play bear. Over and over again, they want to play bear. But that was another thing we did. So these are the kinds of things that I had did with this family, with his children. When I would visit their home, I would hear a little scratching on the door in the morning. I'd look over, and notes would start to come under the door in the morning, and a pen. So I'd have to get up and go pick up the note. Uncle Doug, get up. Breakfast is ready. Or, Uncle Doug, get up, the day's wasting away, or whatever he would say. And I guess the pen was so I could write my answer. I was just right there. Then one day I got a phone call. I picked it up and it was little Danny. Hi, Uncle Doug, da-da-da-da-da-da. Danny, how did you call me? Oh, your phone number is right here next to the phone. And I just dialed it. I said, do your parents know that you're calling me long distance? No, and don't tell them. Because I'll get a whipping. So you see over the course of time how this developed. The other kids would be more likely doing their own thing, but Danny would always be there. And so because of all this interaction, of course, we had gotten close. And then it was as if God said to me, do you get it? Do you understand what I'm trying to tell you? And I thought about it and I said, I get it. I understand what you're telling me. You're trying to tell me that you, God, will be as close to me as I want to be to you. You will be as close to me as I want to be to you. This whole interaction with little Danny was an example to me. The reason that I was closest to Danny probably than the other children, especially growing up, was the fact that he made all of this effort to be around me when I happened to be visiting. The last time I was up here, I spoke about God's love. God's love's immense and big. You have to imagine something like the Amazon River that flows out of Brazil. It just comes, you can't stop it. It's immense, more water than you'd ever need. God's love is more love than you'd ever need, and it just keeps coming. So God is always there. That's a constant. What changes is you. Your relationship to God's love is what changes everything. Is that how most people have their relationship with God? Take a look at this quote from Steps to Christ. We talk about temporal things because we have an interest in them. We talk of our friends because we love them. Our joys, our sorrows are bound up with them. Yet we have an infinitely greater reason to love God than to love our earthly friends. It should be the most natural thing in the world to make him first in all of our thoughts, to talk of his goodness, and to tell of his power. Now, is this the way most people interact with God right now? In the world, no. In the Christian church? Maybe. I'm afraid that a lot of Christians don't understand what this means. They don't have that relationship with God. Let's go back to disciple John for a second. I found something else out about him I wanted to share with you. The Savior's affection for the beloved disciple was returned with all the strength of ardent devotion. John clung to Christ as a vine clings to the stately pillar. For the Master's sake, he braved the dangers of the judgment hall and lingered about the cross. And at the tidings that Christ had risen, he hastened to the sepulcher, in his zeal outstripping even the impetuous Peter. Okay, now you can see a little more about John. And here's a little thing. The depth and fervor of John's affection for the Master was not the cause of Christ's love for him, but the effect of that love. Okay, this is the key. The depth and fervor of John's affection for the Master, for Jesus, was not the cause of Jesus' love for him. It was an effect of that love. Jesus always had the love flowing out to all the disciples. But do you see how John responded differently than the rest? Do you see how deeply interested he was in Christ than the rest? I should say more so than the rest. So it wasn't partiality with John. Jesus wasn't playing favorites. It was that John went out of his way to make that connection strong. And I see the same things happening in the people I've shared the stories about. The people who these miracle things have happened to, their hearts are bound up with God. They're out working for him. They're doing things all the time. They're praying with God often about all the things that are in connection with their ministry and their lives. And I say, that's what they're doing. They have this very strong connection. So how can I make this my connection? That was my next logical question. I was first thinking, well, of course, the scriptures. Just like little Danny spent time with me and he knew better about me and so we had more to talk about, our familiarity with God comes in a big portion because of what we know about the scriptures, right? In the Bible and the Psalms, it says, I will meditate on your precepts and contemplate your ways. I will delight myself in your statutes and I will forget not your word. And you know, Jesus was our example in this, but in childhood, youth, and manhood, Jesus studied the scriptures. As a little child, he was daily at his mother's knee, taught from the scrolls of the prophets. In his youth, the early morning and evening twilight often found him alone on the mountainside among the trees of the forest, spending a quiet hour in prayer and the study of God's word. During his ministry, his intimate acquaintance with the scriptures testifies to his diligence to their study. So Jesus needed time in God's word to learn about him, to become close to him. So do we. Another point that I thought of to get us closer to God is prayer. Do you remember how little Danny found my number next to the phone and called me? Kept on making connections. The phone calls like God and us in prayer. One thread that seems to run through the miracle stories that we share on Better Life is the fact that people are often asking for prayer, and it's in response to the prayer that you see God working. So prayer is our connection with God. There's a quote that I like that I want to share with you. If you find voice and time to pray, God will find time and voice to answer. That's one of those ones you should just print out and put up on your fridge, right? If you find voice and time to pray, God will find time and voice to answer. I love that quote. Do you know how little Danny would slip those notes under the door in the morning? That reminded me of the time that we need to spend with God first thing. First thing in the morning, we need to come to him. Make that connection right away. Another way we grow closer to Christ is by submitting and cooperating with him in his work. Become a partner with God. In John we read, "For I have not spoken on my own authority," this is Jesus talking, "but the Father who sent me gave me a command that I of what I should say and what I should speak. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak." Jesus was our example, and he put himself right under God's command. Whatever the Father says, that's what Jesus does. That was our example. Whatever Jesus says, that's what we do. Same thing. And the thing you see Jesus doing, especially just before the cross, is this quote from Luke 22:42. "Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." I find comfort in this because sometimes there's things we don't want to do, right? And even Jesus found that. He did not want to do that. But he said, I have to submit to God. And in the same way, we have to submit to Jesus. And good will come from it, just like good came from Christ's sacrifice. At work, we get phone calls sometimes from people who need help. And I've told God that I want to cooperate with him when those phone calls come in. I've taped a little quote to the bottom of my computer monitor. Do you want to see what it says? You better say yes, because I'm going to show you anyway. So just say yes. Okay, good. This is the quote. "With almost impatient eagerness, the angels wait for our cooperation. For man must be the channel to communicate with man. And when we give ourselves to Christ in wholehearted devotion, angels rejoice that they can speak through that they may speak through our voices to reveal God's love." So from time to time, I point to that little printout on my computer and say, "Lord, I'm ready. Send somebody, help me. I want to talk to somebody for you." In this way, daily, we can put ourselves under God's power. You know, there's a quote that I like also that talks about what we need to do every day when we plan our plans. Do you guys make your plans for the day? Maybe you're going to go clean out the garage. Maybe you're going to go to the mall or something, whatever it is. But before you do all that, when you rise up in the morning, this is the goal right here. Lay all your plans before God to be carried out or given up, as His providence shall indicate. Accept His plans instead of your own, even though their acceptance requires the abandonment of cherished projects. Okay, so you thought you were going to clean the garage out today. It doesn't happen. Let God take over and do what He needs to do with you that day. It goes on to say, thus the life will be molded more and more after the divine example, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. There is a peace that comes when you do God's will, when you see that you're under His plan. So, what has been the result? Now that I'm focusing more on following God and working with Him, trying to get closer connections happening, those kinds of things. Well, something happened a year or two ago, and it was one of those things that I said, thank you, Lord, for letting me go through this experience. We've made connection with a gentleman over in Crescent City who watches Better Life and the programs, and I've been talking to him almost since I first got here years ago, and he calls me from time to time. And he's so much appreciated what he's learned on Better Life and the other Adventist ministries now. And he once told me, he said, of all the things I'm learning from all the denominations, you folks most closely follow the Bible. You folks make sense, things like that. So we've had a good relationship. I was traveling, I don't know if it was one or two Thanksgivings ago, to go down the coast to be with my brother at Thanksgiving time. And I was driving through Crescent City. And as I was getting close there, I said, Lord, I've never met this man in person, but if it's your will, I would like to meet this man today on my way down to California as I drive through Crescent City. So if it's your will that I meet this man today, have him outside somewhere. And I pulled into town. Now, because we had done contact with him, and I for one, knew what he looked like. I had seen his picture. So I knew what he looked like, but I'd never seen him in person. And because we had sent him material, I knew the area that he lived in. So I put the GPS, and I just was going to go through that area just to see what the Lord would do. Punched in the coordinates, GPS took me down the main street, and then I thought it would have gone a little further, but then it cut off and went down a side street, in my opinion, a little early. Maybe I thought it was the fastest way. And then it turned down another side street. We're in a residential section, and I saw a man walking down the road. As I looked very closely, and as I drove closer, I said, that's got to be him. That's got to be the man walking right towards me. I stopped and I rolled down my window, and I said, hey, and I called out his name. He said, yeah, and he walked over to my car, and I played with him a little while. I said, how you doing? He goes, do I know you? I said, yeah, but we've never met in person. I didn't tell him right off because I wanted to see what he would do. But eventually I told him who I was, and he was surprised. Well, he said, I was just getting ready to go with my son on a Thanksgiving to dinner or something for Thanksgiving, and I decided to walk to the store. That's the reason I'm out here. So do you understand the providence of this? Because there's a narrow window of time that I'm driving through his neighborhood. It's not that big of a town, Crescent City. And there's a narrow time that he would have to be outside walking somewhere for us to actually meet. And he was walking right towards me. So, yes, I'm seeing the Lord move in some wonderful ways. So there are so many blessings to be had if we come close to the Lord in this way. And I just want to encourage you. Another one happened. I wasn't expecting this, but a man called. He was upset. He was here in Grants Pass. He was watching Better Life. And we were talking, and I spent some time with him. We hung up the phone. I don't know, maybe the weekend passed, a few days passed. He called back and said, thank you for taking time to talk to me. I was contemplating suicide. Well, he never said that to me. I never had any clue. But do you see how the Lord works? Brings us together? It's a wonderful thing when you start working with the Lord. So, does God play favorites? No. Because the wonderful thing is that each one of you can be His favorite. God's not like people, limited time and attention. He has unlimited time and attention. He can focus on you as if you were the only person around. So when it comes to favorites, it's not God. It's totally up to you. How close do you want to be to God? Because that's all that really, that's what's going to do, make it. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you're constantly loving us. But our relationship to you, Lord, we can affect that. We can spend more time with you. We can go out of our way, Lord, to just link to you like the vine links to the side of a pillar. We pray, Lord, for a very close relationship to form and to grow all the time with you so that we can be your workers here on this planet to help save more and more people and to be your hands and your feet so much needed in this sinful place. Be with us now, Lord, as we progress into the week. We pray that you will always be by our side. In Jesus' name, amen.